Welcome to Call 100, Mass Media and Society. I'm your instructor, Catherine Clinch. October 29, 1969 is a Wednesday of some importance around the history of our country and around the world. It is the day of birth of Eleni Menagaki, whose name may not be familiar to you, but according to Forbes magazine, she is the sixth and most powerful and influential celebrity in Greece. She is, in fact, the great Oprah. Okay, well, maybe that doesn't hold a lot of bearing in your life. On the same day, Coronation Street, the longest-running soap opera in Britain, aired episode 923 for the first time in living color. Okay, maybe not so much there either. But we had our own living color happening at the same time, so it was a parallel experience. At the same time, on that date, at 10:30 p.m., student programmer Charlie Klein sent the first message over the ARPANET. Now, ARPANET is an acronym for Advanced Research Projects Agency Network. It originated at UCLA and was sent to the Stanford Research Institute. The message was supposed to say, log in. Now, Charlie typed the letter L, and he typed the letter O, and then the system crashed. So at that particular moment, the internet, for better or for worse, was born. We're going to be talking about the internet today and about all the different functions online in this global world that we live in, and the global village that Marshall McLuhan has been talking about and we've been using as a running motif for this class. But first, as always, we have some bookkeeping things to take care of. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor Degree Completion Program. This is broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we'll be broadcasting four classes. Political Science 335 is International Politics. That's broadcast on Tuesdays from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Communications 100 Mass Media Society, which is what you're watching right now, is broadcast on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. Communications 300, Organizational Communications, is on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. immediately following this class. Sociology 315 is the Sociology of Work. This is broadcast on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete the program for a bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years. And then we'll start all over again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, you can visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or call 866-277-6789. Now, as always, we have pretty specific learning objectives for this afternoon. We're going to take a look at those right now. By the end of this program, students will understand the origins of the internet. Students will be able to describe the various ways the world uses the internet, and students will be able to discuss the emerging trends in Web2 functions and usage. Now, the mid-50s in America were the time of peace and hope. The Korean War ended in July 1953. We hadn't jumped into Vietnam yet. The Cold War was getting colder, and Eisenhower and Khrushchev had their very public spat, which resulted in Khrushchev saying, quote, whether you like it or not, we will bury you. To which Eisenhower said, let's shift some of the spending from the military-industrial complex and focus on building up those nuclear missiles for the peacetime security that when we go to war, we'll have a definitive weapon. All of this was going on at a time when sisters were becoming popular, people were becoming more relaxed, we had those fabulous 50s, design was going wild, color was emerging everywhere. We had the boogie architecture that was popping up in coffee shops and office buildings. It was a time when we decided we could be modern. We started having ideas that there was something great in our future. But at the same time, we were looking at a point of time that we were going to be going into tumultuous 60s. So while all of the social factors of fashion and pop art and all of those wonderful fun things would emerge, we also had science and technology that were very heavily funded by the Department of Defense. Now, the race to space is very clearly a political issue. Because, yes, we want to get into space, but we want to get there first. If you see the right stuff, you notice that there were a lot of efforts that just kind of sputtered. We would send a missile up, it would crash, it would come flying down to the Earth. We would send a missile up, and it would go up about 3 feet, and then blow up. So we had a lot of frustrating starts. And then, in 1957, when the Soviets successfully launched Sputnik, it sent us a little kind of tailspin. We'd lost the race to space. The first baby steps. But that was enough to start thinking about what else can we own? What are the things that we can do? Now, there were a lot of dark times for American morale because the Cold War was building up. There were tensions, there were things that we had to take into effect with our daily life. And so, while we were supposed to be the greatest, the best, and the brightest, we were still, on some levels, tenuously holding on to our position as world leaders. We knew that somewhere over in the other hemisphere, there were countries like the U.S., the Soviet Socialist Republic, China, all of these big emerging giants that were somewhat threatening to us. And so, while NASA kept creating missiles, finally the ones that took off and enabled us to really kind of win that space race in the long run, the U.S. realized that if it wasn't going to lose its technological superiority, if they wanted to keep their edge, they were going to have to fund the development. In 1958, the Department of Defense created the ARPA, the Advanced Research Projects Agency. Okay? They organized the smartest minds in America. These worked very well with the Manhattan Project when they brought over the smartest people that they could find, put them all together in an isolated location, and had them work collaboratively on the same topic. Now, collaboratively is always a very important aspect because when you have people who are competing academically and can't share the knowledge, every little step has to be discovered independently. And that's not the most effective way to do things. So, the ARPA started working with some of the top universities. They didn't have an idea that generated at MIT. They sat down and created a system where we're going to be looking at an image in a moment of Leonard Conrock and Shirley Klein, who were at UCLA. But it was a start putting together the technological process of being able to create a system that would enable people to communicate. It was supposed to be because it was funded by the Defense Department. It was supposed to be for reasons of national security. Now, these two fellows in the picture, you can barely see the assistant Charlie Klein, but these two fellows are about to change the world. We have no idea what's going to happen. Now, it's the combination of innocence and ambition and time that all come together and enable them to create the internet. They didn't know that at the time, okay? The personality profile of academics comes into play here because people have a concept of the ivory tower and the erudite conversations that are going on behind the walls. It's not so much what happens in the environment, but what happens because all the people who come together with similar personalities who function in that environment on specific topics. Academics are conditioned, either by nature or training, to define a problem. Not only think about it, and sometimes they overthink about it, but it's that thought process that enables the level of discovery. But then because in some levels and at some institutions, people are considered, it's not so much to be independent thinking that's good. Let's see what everybody else is doing. Let's see who supports your thought process here. So there's a lot of research that happens. There's research about who's already done what, and then there's research about what specifically can be expected from a particular project. With that research information, then there's the process of pondering. Let's think it over. Let's see where it goes next. Then we debate it, because people will always have different opinions. Finally, there's always a push to publish, but when the Defense Department is funding you, there's not going to be a lot of publication. But there's still that sense of organize everything into the same intellectual formats if you were going to publish it for peer review. Now, Eisenhower had very strong opinions about the military-industrial complex, but he was also a general. And so the Department of Defense was still focused on the mentality that totally differed from academics. It's a get-it-done mentality. It's need to heal. It's go and get the job done. Leave no wounded behind. It's the military. It's what makes generals good. It's what makes soldiers brave. And it's totally in opposition to the things that make academics great and academics brave. So the Defense Department funded the early stages. And it was the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA. They were not paying to develop online shopping. They were not paying to develop anything that the internet would ultimately become. However, they saw it as a tool for defense-related goals, so they wanted it done efficiently and effectively, and they went to the top universities. It was thought to be an emergency communication system that they could use during times of crisis. Remember, we had to use the nuclear bombs. We knew that Russia was developing them, and we also knew that we had the potential to destroy the whole world. So it had to have a system that could communicate under the strictest crisis levels. Plus, security. They wanted to be able to have private conversations between government agencies, academic research facilities working under government contract. They wanted to be able to control security. And by having this ARPANET, they would be able to limit access to the people that they wanted to have involved in the conversation. Also, surveillance, because there were ways to see who had entered what at what particular time. That was part of the initial design. In fact, who knows what else? Because when you're dealing with the government, you don't always know everything. That's, from my point of view, a good idea. I'm not a fan of the WikiLeaks that we're seeing right now. I think it's a good idea to have a little discretion, so to speak. So on October 29th, 1969, we had a first transmission between UCLA and Stanford. 1 hour after the first crash, the connection was reestablished, and a full log-in message was transmitted. So, Leonard Kleinrock and Charlie Klein gave birth to the internet, but they still had to think and overthink and ponder and debate. And what we have here, coming up as this next image, is the first ARPANET IMP log. Well, IMP stands for Interface Message Processors, and the Advanced Research Projects Agency Network, which would ultimately be called the Internet. This is the only document that records this monumental event. It's a handwritten note in a logbook, and frankly, one of the importance of what was being done. It's like, okay, we got to the first step, now what happens? So this was not considered to be a landmark document, although, as it turns out, it is. And by December 5th, 1969, a four-node connection was established between UCLA, Stanford, UC Santa Barbara, and the University of Utah. Those were the first four IMPs, Internet Message Processors, that were in existence on the Internet. Now, because history is amazing and the Internet is even better, we're going to take a trip at UCLA professor Leonard Kleinrock talking about the birth of the Internet and explaining to you exactly how it was done. We may not have the document, but we have his exact words, so let's take a look.
So let me describe the events that took place at the time of the birth of the Internet. Here at UCLA, we had a time-shared computer, which is a scientific data systems, Sigma 7. And it was serving the population of undergraduate and graduate students, as well as the faculty. Just a computer running time sharing in the 60s. When we decided to create this network, the idea was to build a switch, which we called an interface message processor. And that was delivered to us on the Labor Day weekend from Boca Raton back in Cambridge, Massachusetts. It's the size of a refrigerator. It's what we now call a router. That time we called it a packet switch, because it was using and implementing the packet switching technology that I had developed as a graduate student at MIT. So on September 2nd, the day after Labor Day, we connected this switch to our Sigma 7, and bits began to flow immediately. Everybody was there that day, wondering, will it work? And everybody wanted to point the finger at each other, and it didn't. Happily, it worked just fine. The next day, we had messages moving back and forth. So this is UCLA. And the time was September 1969. A month later, up at SRI, Stanford Research Institute, another group arrived in October. And shortly thereafter, they connected their host computer, which was a PDP machine, program data processor machine, a digital equipment machine, to their IP. So this is Stanford Research Institute, SRI, and the period is October 69. So we decided that we would log on from our machine to their machine. And the idea was, we sit down as if we were a local user on this machine and log on through the network to that machine. Of course, we needed a communications link, and so the first piece of the backbone network ever on the internet was that line from UCLA to SRI. And so, on October 29th, 1969, one of my programmers, Charlie Klein, and I were in this room, and we decided to log on to this machine. Now, to log on, one has to type in, one has to type in L-O-G, and the remote machine will type in the IN. So our job had simply to type in L-O-G. Now, up at the other end, there was another programmer waiting to watch all of this. And we had a telephone connection between these two. Telephone connection so they could talk to each other. What happened is, Charlie typed the L, and he asked, "You get the L?" And the answer was, "Not the L." He typed the O. You get the O? Got the O. He typed the G. You get the G? Locked out. The system crashed. This machine went down. So the very first message on the internet ever was lo, as in lo and behold. You couldn't ask for a better, more effective message. Now, a month later, another ink was delivered to a University of California, Santa Barbara, and they connected their hosting, of course. And we had a couple more lines connecting these things together. And this was in November of 69. And a month after that, a fourth beep was deployed at the University of Utah, and they connected their house computer in. So we had, December 69. So we had a 4-node network running, and we began to test it and find out what some of the problems were, and we could break this network anytime we wanted. We found faults, we had BBM fixes, etc. So this was the beginning of the internet. You might say that on September 2nd, when this first connection was made, the internet took its first breath of life. And when this message was sent from UCLA to SRI, you might say that the internet uttered its first words. The interesting thing is that we did not have a prepared message to send. If you remember that Samuel Morse had a terrific message, one of God wrote. And Alexander Graham Bell had, "Come here, Watson, I need you." And Armstrong said, "A giant leap for mankind." Those guys were smart. They understood about public relations and media. They had the press, they had TV in the face of the TV was around. They had recordings, and the record is there. We have no record of this. There was no camera. There was no recording. There was nobody present except a few of us doing this simple connection. We do have a written record of it in a log that we kept. And I'll be happy to show that log, which records that very first message. In this box, we have probably the most precious document regarding the history of the Internet. And it contains the original ink log in which we recorded the events that took place in those early days. We started recording this in October. And we have the entries by the programmers and the software developers. And the most important entry in this document is shown right here. On October 29th, 1969, at 10:30 in the evening, Charlie Klein put in the entry, "Talk to SRI host to host." That's the record of that first message, low, that was sent between us and SRI. This is the only document that exists to record the birth of the Internet.
Here's one of the most important things to take away. Not that they weren't prepared for infamy, but for the fact that every single day, chances are you use the Internet. And you've probably never heard the name Leonard Kleinrock. Now, this is one of the problems of being an academic. You can be one of the most brilliant thinkers, and unless you're Einstein, who suddenly winds up in the public eye, there's anonymity. And academics will toil in anonymity because they believe in what they're doing, but it's still a little frustrating to think about. Now, while this was going on, how much of the future could scientists or the public have foreseen for the Internet? They were focused on the assignment, which was working for the Department of Defense. But according to the next book that was done in 1961, some people saw the potential for computers to have e-commerce, including shipping and tracking, online banking, QuickBooks, and digital surveillance systems. Let's take a look at this brief quote. Sorry, there's no sound on that clip. Basically, it was kind of the sort of promotions that we did around the New York World's Fair in 1964 and 65. The world of the future. Great, big, beautiful tomorrow. So now, when we look at the Internet and the system they developed, it's built around the system of packet switching. Now, packet switching is a set of protocols that divides messages into smaller packets in order to send them. Packets are sent separately. They may go through different routes, they may go through the same route, but ultimately they're reassembled at the destination so that the message makes sense. Now, for 10 years after the first node connection was established, packet switching was an advanced technology and had to develop as quickly as possible in order to make it work. Ultimately, it became the dominant system for data communication worldwide. Now, the image behind me is a visualization of the various routes through a portion of the Internet. Each of those dots and lines presumably represents a packet. Now, in 1980, funding for the Internet increased, and it started to make the Internet a commercial viability. We've all heard that Al Gore created the Internet. He never actually said that. He enabled funding for the Internet. And that was enabled to grow by sponsoring bills that provided funding. Which specific bill do you think he sponsored? It was called the High Performance Computing and Communications Act of 1991. That was the bill that enabled funding so that we could all take those little computers we had on our desk and move beyond a system of BBS and DSL and start to get to a point where the Internet has arrived today. The National Science Foundation also had a lot of money coming into it, and private investors and benefactors became involved as well. We're going to be talking about that kind of investment later in the program when our guest is here. Now, the Internet, at its very basis, is interconnected computer networks. Millions of computers link by an assortment of networking technologies. We have hardwire electronics, wireless routers, and fiber optics, which are the most effective. Now, what we come up with is a network of networks. We're going to be looking at an image of that in a moment. And we have a global system that breaks down into tiny elements. If you see the messages hopping back and forth between the continents, this is something that in the beginning, we were looking at a system that stretched between a couple of universities. Ultimately, it's become a system that stretches worldwide. Theoretically, up to the space station. Theoretically, as we travel into planets and beyond, it'll come with us there, and it'll continue to develop. But basically, it's a global system that breaks down into tiny elements. Private home computers, public computers, academic institutions, businesses, and government computers. All of those combine together to create a global network that facilitates a number of essential functions. Communication, because we have to be talking to each other. Remember we talked in the first session of the class about how if we had developed in every way except mass media, how would we be able to have developed in the other areas? We have research, because now doctors and scientists are able to communicate with each other so they can not have to keep reinventing the wheel every time, share through publication and peer review and commentary. Education is crucial element to the internet to provide information that educates individuals whether or not they're enrolled in specific coursework. Finally, entertainment, because we have to have a delivery system that becomes more efficient than the things that we were using in the early 20th century. Massive investment in internet technology and software is what was key to making this go to the next level. That's why later on today we're going to be talking to someone who consults with venture capitalists and startup companies. It is the element of money that drives things to the point where they can actually build and grow. There's massive hype and potential payoff. Okay? Remember the tech bubble in the 90s? You had a lot of people throwing money at a lot of different ideas, and they all sounded brilliant. Everything was the next this, the next that. What initially happened was there was a thing that hurt. People threw a lot of money at things that didn't ultimately work, and to people who were not investment worthy, so to speak. Money was wasted, the companies closed, venture capitalists, a lot of them went out of business as well. But it was the thinning of the herd that promoted survival of the fittest. The companies that survived were the companies that went on to create the current generation of internet. Now, 1990 was a pivotal point in the commercialization of the internet. Three things had to happen in order to make this work. You had to have institutional adoption. So you had government, and you had education, and you had industry. All of those institutions needed to say, this is something good. We can work with this. We can make this a tool that will help us deliver what we need to deliver and communicate. You had to have consumer popularization. You had to have the desire. I want to be involved in that because it suits a need that I have emotionally. It had to be available to the average consumer, and then it had to be functional. So you're talking about affordability, and you're talking about something that's user-friendly. Finally, there has to be global adoption. When we started with the World Wide Web, it really wasn't worldwide. It was really centric in the United States. And gradually, it became adopted around the world. All of these spread once the applications for the internet were available and functioning. They were clearly defined and put into operation. Now, business transactions were an important element of this. The first thing that businesses think about is business-to-business, or B2B, as it was called. In B2B, you have websites. By this point in time, basically you're not in business until you are officially on a website. You have sales and promotional material flying back and forth between companies, and you have newsletters, podcasts, e-commerce, because even businesses sell services that need to be paid for, seminar, conference, and promotion and sales, because the more technology we have, the more conferences we have, and you have social networks that are business-driven, like LinkedIn and sort of Plaxo. Now, the image behind me is B2B versus B2C, because business-to-consumer was the next level of involvement in the business transactions. Now, there's really not a lot of difference. Difference focuses on the target demographic, because they're using the same processes as B2B, and in a lot of ways, they're using the same kind of format to be sending things out. However, instead of small businesses, you have a lot of vanity websites. I, for example, on KatherineClinch.com, this place to park my resume and a couple of other comments and a way for people to get in touch with me. But I always recommend that everybody own their own name.com, because who knows when it'll come in handy. There are newspapers that are online now, and newsletters. I get, unfortunately, still more than 200 emails a day. A lot of them are newsletter aggregators that are B2B, but also some of them are just things like, excuse me, Michael's Crafts sends me coupons, and I appreciate that. There are store websites. And going back to coupons, you've got companies like Groupons, who are being using the power of connectivity in order to offer better opportunity to people. So a company says, well, by using Groupon, I can reach a larger percentage of the audience. Instead of putting that money into advertising, at least if I give it in coupons, I know exactly how many people have come to redeem the coupon. Groupon is in the process of preparing an IPO because it has been so successful, and they believe with a little more capital, they can be far more successful than anyone else. Now, collective buying power is a key incentive because when we look at consumer-driven transactions, think of how the internet drove the power of eBay, which originated as a place online where people could trade Beanie Babies. Again, humble beginnings turn into huge opportunities. Once you have something, it takes the intelligence of the users and the corporation behind the technology and software to figure out how else it can be used. So you've got eBay. You've got systems like Craigslist, which, for better or for worse, is a place where people can transact consumer-to-consumer business. All of these transactions require monetary transfers. So you have companies like PayPal emerging. Entertainment applications, another key. Business equals commerce with financial transactions. So you've got movie downloads, which, if the DVDs are going lower, instead of thinking that maybe they're not making movies that people want to own forever and watch over and over, the studios and the networks are saying, well, we'll do downloads. It's because they don't want to buy the thing, they want to have a download. So now we have movie downloads. We also have music downloads. Television episodes repurposed. You can watch them anytime, anywhere. Magazines. We looked last week at Project by Richard Branson, which is the first magazine developed uniquely for online. But most other magazines are repurposing to websites, so they have the online present as well. Book downloads, developing through the internet and then into Kindle and iPad and iPhone and all the other places you can read books. And e-books, they're written specifically to be purchased and consumed over the internet and on technology but never printed onto paper. User-generated content as well. We're all familiar with YouTube. In fact, you may be watching this on the CSUDH TV channel of YouTube. We have mashups, where consumers take one piece of professional created art or movie or music and make something else in it, some kind of toy. We have manifestos where people will go in and create their system of beliefs and share it, sometimes built around a business, sometimes not. My personal one is nuclearfamilyfilms.com. I have a manifesto up there that is designed to appeal to moms. There are also blogs. There are so many blogs that now there are organizations' blogs. If you're a woman and you blog, you might be involved with Blogger. You might be a mommy blogger, you might be a business blogger. Whatever kind of blog people have is available at any time, and some people are absolutely able to get so many readers consistently that they can sell advertising. Educational applications. Think about what we're doing right now. You're watching me, and behind me, you watched me last week. This is, of course, tagged specifically over the internet. The students who are enrolled in this class will then go on to a system called Blackboard, where we'll communicate. They'll turn in their homework assignments, we'll have discussions, they'll be graded on the performance of the classwork, not because they show up in the room and smile at me and say, well, you look lovely today, Mrs. Fish. They do it on the internet because they have the availability of access to education that they wouldn't otherwise have. so that we are able to use the internet to reach out to students who are either not close enough to a college campus, but still have a desire to get a degree. Maybe they are young mothers who can't find childcare, or single mothers who have to take a class at the end of the day when the children are in bed. All of this is available because of the internet technology. Now, as an out of mediated instruction and distance learning, we look at the personal applications. Email. How many messages do you send an email per day through the internet? We have social networks. Facebook is the obvious biggie, but we've also got others. Just the other day, I got an email from MySpace. Where have you been? Why don't you come back and visit us? I thought that was kind of fascinating outreach. Photo sharing. We have scrapbooks online, journals online, we have home movies online. People can watch all of their private memorabilia in one specific place and share it. You no longer have to go to the drugstore and print out a bunch of pictures to send grandma of the kids. You can post it on your website, send it an email, and the convenience is there. Music. We have no more music sharing, but we can download music to own and keep our personal library on the computer. Financial records. This is sort of iffy, but most of the different banks have protections in place, and there's precautions that can be taken. Religious ministry. Here's one I found fascinating. The Vatican is now telling priests to reach out to the congregation through the internet. Let's take a look at this very short clip.
The Pope's message for the 44th World Communications Day will be published on the Feast of St. Francis of Sales, the patron saint of journalists. This message, which falls within the year of the priests, has as its theme the priest and pastoral ministry in a digital world, new media and the service of the word. Jean-François Dia, director of the Jules Hope Institute, is in Freiburg, Switzerland, explained that the message is in part dedicated to the internet and the church's reflection on its use. The Catholic Church, for some time now, has demonstrated a great interest in the social communications media, which the internet has been included. In this regard, the Church has published important documents that reflect on the use of the internet and the Church's presence on the internet. However, the Church does not simply survey the internet to reflect on the possible use of these new networks. From the Vatican to the laity and including priests, she is equally involved. On one hand, there are official initiatives. There is a very important Vatican website, which was developed with the initiative and encouragement of John Paul II, as well as diocesan websites. Likewise, there are many personal initiatives from different groups from within the Catholic Church and from individuals. For example, the expansion of blogs that are run by priests. According to the Pontifical Council for Social Communications, this year's message invites priests to consider the new media as a powerful resource for their ministry in the service of the word, and encourages them to address the challenges that arise from the new digital culture.
So you see, even the church's outreach is going online now. We have communications applications. We've already talked about blogs. But the interesting thing with blogs is they've developed into a new form of journalism. It's called citizen journalism. It's more accessible, it's more one-on-one, and it's more peer review. It enables the average citizen who is at a point of time in history and proximity to start reporting on things from an independent point of view that may or may not differ from the press, but probably enlightens us from a more emotional, independent context. Now, Marshall McLuhan's Global Village exists because the internet enabled it. When you think about all of the things we talked about in the 50s before any of this was actually even close to being a reality, it's the tool of this facilitated the communication that enables us to be global in our communication on a mass scale. So we're going to take a look now at an image on the full screen, please. This is a diagram of Marshall McLuhan's Village, and let's be full screen here. you can see that the key mechanism begins with trust right here. Okay? Cover that up. But trust, take a look at that right there, is curated information. It implies that someone has vetted it for you and determined that it's accurate and that it has a sense of importance to you. It's kind of a carryover from old media. But then also communication right here. Information can be transmitted with ease. It's accessible to all, and there's a sense of inclusion that is very comforting. Now, over here are the sources from the individual to the community to society. These are all feeding into the same trust and communication flow as the others, so that the outcomes of the benefits are direct gratification produced by trust and communication, as well as capital benefits, facilitation of collaboration, co-coordination of functions, social support. All of these were crucial. So let's come back full screen. One of the things that we've come to realize is essential to the function of communications in the 21st century is full inclusion of the disabled. Now, in order to access the internet, the deafblind must have reasonable accommodations. We're going to take a look at a clip from Congressman Ed Markey, Democrat of Massachusetts, talking on deafblind access to the internet in the 21st century. Let's take a look.
On the 20th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act, which the first President George Bush signed into law, underscoring the nonpartisan nature of this vital issue.
At the time, he said that the shameful walls of exclusion finally come tumbling down. 20 years ago, the ADA mandated physical ramps into buildings. Today, individuals with disabilities need online ramps to the internet so that they can get to the web from wherever they happen to be. The bill we are considering today significantly increases accessibility for Americans with disabilities through the indispensable telecommunications and video technology tools of the 21st century. By making web access easier through improved user interfaces for smartphones. Enabling Americans who are blind to enjoy TV fully through audible descriptions of the on-screen action. Making cable TV program guides and selection menus accessible to people with vision loss. Below-income Americans who are deaf and blind. Providing a share of the total of $10 million per year of funding to purchase internet access and telecom services so these individuals can more fully participate in society. Annie Sullivan used special language she spelled in Helen Keller's column. In the 21st century, we have moved from tracing letters of the alphabet in a column to navigating a column pilot. And we must make sure that all of these modern devices are accessible. The iPad is something that today makes it possible for Amy Sullivan and Helen Keller to be able to access with a touch. So it's not just like touching the palm like it was in Annie and Helen's day, but it's about touching the pad, touching these devices, having him speak to them, having the ability to be able to speak in a way that has a conversation with all of the rest of us in society. Technology needs to be the teacher.
Now, this is one of the issues that has a special role of importance to me because Owen sounds as profoundly deaf. And at some point in his teenage years, I kept raising concerns because he was spending a lot of time in game rooms that had group interaction. And I asked him why he was so caught up in this, and his response was very simple. "Because none of them know that I'm deaf," he said. Now, images and words with touchscreen audio enable the blind to hear what they cannot see. Closed captioning enables the deaf to see and read what they cannot hear. These are important because active members of our society who are denied access to the basic things that we all share cannot reach their truest potential. Now, the year 2000 was when entertainment content really started to break onto the internet. The concept of TV everywhere was just a rumor at the time, but now it's starting to develop significantly. All of the TV networks have their own online sites. They have programming that they run. They have extra content for fans. They have communication on some of these sites between fans and their favorite characters. That also includes a social network component. It's not uncommon for every character on the series to have their own Facebook page. By 2009, one quarter of the Earth's population was using the internet. Now think about that. One quarter of everybody on this planet has access and uses the internet regularly. The Defense Department has found some interesting ways to use it. Now, we're going to take a look at a different perspective on how the Defense Department has started posting what is typically called drone porn. People who like to follow military adventures are following footage that's posted on the internet of drones bombing war sites, targets. Call them what you may, they are destroying property and or life. And so it's been considered drone porn. After we take a look at this clip, I'll tell you the source of the news broadcast, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Let's take a look at the clip.
The use of unmanned drones in both Afghanistan and Pakistan by America was widespread in 2009, but it seems the U.S. military isn't the only place that drones have become increasingly popular lately. Videos of the attacks have become an internet hit, after being released on YouTube, like Teaser. At the website, we're doing researchers in Washington studio tonight to talk about this. Hi there, Dana. So what's behind this new internet sensation? Are we talking morbid curiosity or a genuine fascination with the latest military technology, or maybe a bit of both? What's the story here?
Well, Kevin, it is safe to say that these videos, now referred to as drone porn, are becoming more and more popular, attracting tens of millions of viewers. Now, it's also interesting to point out that the Defense Department puts up these videos. So, what message are they trying to send across? Well, joining me to discuss comes Keith Thompson from Alabama. He recently wrote a very interesting article about this issue in the Huffington Post. Keith, the first question that I have to ask you, of course, is why is the Department of Defense putting up these videos? What are they trying to say? Because look, if you're logging onto YouTube and you're searching murders and you're sitting there watching a murder take place, you could very well be considered a sick person. So what exactly makes this okay?
Well, I guess I should begin by saying that I'm a novelist first and foremost, and I found out about unmanned aerial vehicles, which are commonly referred to as drones, during my research for my book. I have a book called Once a Spy that Doubleday is publishing in March. And I write for the Huffington Post. I just am out there looking for a good story. And I think the thing that made this a big story was that America was doing it, that the Department of Defense is doing it. And your question is why. And I think that in large part, it's part of the effort towards transparency on the part of the Department of Defense. These aircraft will absolutely shift the paradigm of war in the future. And the Department of Defense is enabling Americans to be part of the dialogue.
But do you think that this is in America's best interest?
Well, I think that it's the Department of Defense, it's in their interest on behalf of America because this enables them to promote this new weapon system. This year is the first year that I believe more unmanned aircraft will be produced, or at least have they been ordered by the Department of Defense, than manned. The production is unable to meet the demand. These systems have been so effective, they just can't make enough of them.
Let's get back to the topic of these YouTube videos, because you have these people watching it. Why do you think now, more than ever, they're so fascinated with this scenario? I mean, could you say that some people are just becoming desensitized to this kind of unconventional warfare, where they can literally sit there, click play, and watch somebody get murdered? Let's get back to that topic, because yes, unmanned vehicles are becoming more popular. Let's talk about the fact that the whole world now, not just people in the United States, can watch these things, and whether the Department of Defense says that they're murdering criminals or whatnot, it's still a murder taking place in front of our very eyes.
I think you're right in the respect that the whole world can do this. There are a number of jihadist websites that have posted beheadings and television stations as well that have broadcast beheadings live. And the world has been watching this for years. The news story here really is that the United States is doing it. The rest of the world has been doing this for a long time. The fact that the Department of Defense is posting this sort of video is what's new. This isn't really American style. This is a departure. And I think that...
Well, you're saying it's not really American style, but yet these unmanned air vehicles are being produced more and more and more. I want to thank you, Keith, for speaking with us. Keith Thompson from Alabama, columnist for the Huffington Post. Kevin, I'm going to throw it back to you in Moscow, but I know the first thing you're going to do when you're done is go on YouTube and search.
I saw this clip and I started wondering, why are they giving the weather report in Moscow? And then I discovered that RT.com stands for Russia Today. Now, while I'm awaiting news of whether or not my guest has arrived yet, let's take a look at the website RT.com. A couple of interesting things to take note of. Last week we were talking about the far-right political rhetoric and propaganda. Okay? They talked about how brainwashing occurred very subtly. Now, if you look at this site, RT's motto is question more. This is fascinatingly ironic in the historical context of what Russian politics and communications have been. But look at the headlines here. Freedom overload, a touchy subject. When you go into that story, when you go to the next one here, Washington's nonprofit industrial complex. So when we take a look at this story, the allegations are that the NGOs, non-government organizations, are actually taking a lot of the money that's intended for a charitable purpose in Haiti. It's kind of allegations that may or may not be founded, but they don't really give you an opportunity to see both sides of the argument. Now, when you look over here, you're seeing some of the different stories that are out, and how they put the spin for their own. You can see that Russian women have taken the Relay Gold in an event. For example, here's one, fiery. Schmidt steps down Google, even evil no more. Now, I don't have a whole lot of personal information, but I have met Eric Schmidt, and I found him to be a somewhat non-evil individual who is running a business extremely effectively. Jeannie Court, who is the president of Consumer Watchdog, who is part of this conversation, and again, far from someone who is a Nazi communist, I've met him and talked to him, undercover, he was working with organizations that are supported by Ralph Nader. Now, I don't know the consumer watchdog is. I suspect it is. But I do know that the politics are there to question, which is healthy and normal. Yet, on a website that is focused from the Russian point of view, how many people are being swayed by this personage without equal voice? So you might want to take a look at RT.com and get a look for yourself, because it's really fascinating once you realize that it is from a different government and a different social structure point of view. Now, when we look at net neutrality, this is a key issue that is looming on the frontiers of the internet, because corporations have not always worked in the public's best interest. They work in the corporation's best interest, which, according to the rules of corporation, are exactly what they're supposed to do. But government regulation can be quite helpful. So we're going to take a brief look at a clip from a perspective of what net neutrality is and why we need it.
Let's take a look. Net neutrality. Net neutrality is about choice. Who chooses the content you see and use on the internet? Right now, you do. You connect to the internet, open your browser, and navigate to the website of your choice. Net neutrality makes this possible because it prevents your internet provider from blocking access to those websites. What if one day you decided to look up something on Google, but found their website to be running so painfully slow that you could not use it? Or worse yet, you tried to navigate to Google.com, but you could not connect to it. So, instead, after much frustration, you decided to log on to the website of a different search engine to find what you wanted. Without net neutrality, the above scenario could become all too common. Your network provider, the company that operates your physical connections to the internet, might decide to degrade your access to a website like Google or block access entirely. Why would your provider do such a thing? Perhaps they signed an exclusive agreement with another search engine company. It would then be in the provider's best interest to divert you to that other company's service. Or, perhaps the provider developed its own search engine and wants your business, so it uses its power to control your internet connection to encourage you to use their search engine instead of Google's by degrading or blocking access to Google. Here's another scenario. Say you want to use Vonage for your phone service. One day, out of the blue, perhaps the Vonage service seems weak or filled with static, or perhaps it doesn't work at all. A few months later, your network provider begins offering its own internet phone service. Was Vonage really that bad, or did your network provider have something to do with it? Voice is just one application that runs over the internet. ISPs are getting into the video content provider business, so they'll soon be competing with other video providers on the net too. If your ISP has a financial interest in one provider's content, your ISP has the incentive to degrade your access to any other provider's content. Scenarios like these are not only possible, they've already happened. They will continue to happen as long as basic net neutrality principles are not enforceable. Unfortunately, the folks in Congress don't think net neutrality is important enough to put into law. If you care about surfing wherever you want to on the internet, it's a good time to tell your member of Congress to enforce net neutrality.
Since that video was made, the SEC has definitely decided to push it through. And that's because it's good for consumers, but also because I wonder if any of those people had the same experience I did, which was Apple TV, and it was just, no matter how many times I tried to use it, really hard to download anything that I wanted to see, except when I take it to the Genius part, it says working perfectly. Yet, when I wanted to download the same movie on demand from Time Warner Cable, it seemed to download perfectly. Is it a coincidence? Is it a conspiracy? You decide. We can ponder it and then debate it a later time. Now, the bottom line is, we are here to talk about what's going to happen with the future of the internet and mass media. I've started a little theory that we're going to end every session with. And I've said very clearly that I believe that funny talk videos are the future of entertainment as we know it. But now the theory develops to the next step. Let's take a look at this funny dog video. Then we're going to have a chance to, 10 weeks from now, discuss exactly why I feel the way I do. So here we go with a funny dog, useful dog tricks.
A cup of coffee in the morning, and I get the paper. I check the headlines, I decide to buy a board. I check my email, and I decide to answer a reader. Another cup of coffee, and I turn myself to work. But I just don't hear the thunder from the foggy sweet timber. I'm not boring, I just think to my neighbor.
And there we have it. Cute little Jesse. Why is this the future of entertainment? What do you think about it? Think about funny cat videos. Think about some of the other things we've seen. We're going to be talking about this in depth by the time we finish this course. Now, just so you know, Jesse has been viewed by 7,159,941 people. So I'm going to be watching to see if that count goes up by at least 32. Because every student in this class needs to be checking all of this stuff out. We have a guest for today. Joan Tamer is a widely acclaimed strategic consultant to technology and media CEOs in both the U.S. and worldwide. Her work helps create funds for both for founders and investors of entrepreneurial ventures, and a high return on investment for Fortune 500 companies that she's consulted for. Her capital strategies drive up her clients' valuations and profitability. She has special expertise in working with emerging and disruptive technologies. She consults Fortune 500 companies, capitalized startups, and investment funds, often serving as the shadow CEO to extend her clients' bandwidth. Her clients included J.P. Morgan Capital, Sony, IBM, Apple, Hearst, Blockbuster, Technicolor, HarperCollins, Discovery Channel, Time Warner, Agfa, and many other early-stage ventures such as EarthWeb and iSupply. She's consulted since the early days of the PC, heard about Web 2.0 and Web 3.0 plans today. She speaks and publishes widely. Thank you so much, Joan. So, we're looking at economics in the tech field and the venture world.
Yes. Well, we've had two really bad years since the crash in the fourth quarter of 2008, legible economic crash. And so, 2009, not very much capital got invested. 2010, there was a lot of press that the numbers were going up for the number of deals and the amount of money being moved into new-stage, early-stage companies. But it is more press than it was reality. Then I just come back from chairing the venture panel at the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas, and there's even more optimism now from the venture capitalists that they will be investing at least as much as last year. So it's interesting. They expect to invest more this year because the valuations are going up, which is better for the entrepreneur, but they don't need to do more deals, so it's still very competitive out there.
Investors decide if they want to invest. I mean, when you say the valuations are going up, there are indicators. Like, what kind of things would they look at?
Okay, the first thing that an investor looks at is, is there a market in either mergers and acquisition, we call it M&A, or the IPO market, the going public market, for them if they build a company over the next 5 years or so? Is there a market for them to be able to exit and get their return on investment? Then there's an exit market, then they tend to be more interested in earlier stage companies that they can start in case they can get a Facebook or a Google on their portfolio roster. What they're interested in the company itself is excellent management, generally that's done again. So if you're a successful second or third time entrepreneur, it's much easier to get funded than if you're the first time. But even with the first time, they want to know that you have deep experience in what you're going to build and that you can manage it, scale it, that's growing, and then exit it. They want a unique media or technology property that's in an empty space or a nearly empty market space that can scale and then can be defensible. So that you have the unique new idea, but you fail to execute against it, and then the big guns come in after you've proven the market, and they take it away from you. So basically, they're looking for excellent management, a unique play in a reasonably empty market space, you're either the first or the second, and you have the management expertise to grow it and scale it, and you have some way to defend against somebody taking it away from you after you've proven the market. That's a start.
So what point does the capital strategy come in?
As early as possible. That's what has to happen. I think when you're starting a company, you need to know how you're going to exit it. And it sounds silly, but if you start at the end and work to the beginning, you will actually build strategies that work towards that end. If you don't know how you're going to exit, then your strategies aren't going in a direction to a certain outcome. And there is outcome. You can sell the company to a strategic buyer. You can take it public on the IPO market. Or you can keep the company and create a cash cow. But based on those three kinds of exits, you're going to take a different kind of early stage money. You're going to attract a certain kind of investor, and you're going to accept different money for each kind. So your plan for how you're going to build your capital through all of the rounds of investment is different based on what kind of company you're growing to what kind of exit.
Talk about the different kinds of money. And what are the angel and venture? What is talking about private money, which is friends and family and private high net worth individuals who are not in a group, not an angel group, not a professional association, not a venture capital firm. So private investors are everything from your Uncle George and your Aunt Lizzie, right, to a private investor who simply does it on his own because he knows the market and he's interested in what you're doing. That's one kind of money. And angel investment tends to be a group of people who are banded together to pool their funds and make choices among the lots of companies come to see them. And they expect you to invest in one, at least one or two every year. So those are groups. Then there are early stage boutique venture capitalists and bigger venture capitalists. And they have a very professional eye. They're using institutional money, pension money and insurance company money, that kind of thing. And so the venture capitalists are much more interested in the growth stage. that some of the smaller boutique venture capitalists will invest in early stage. The early stage to them usually means you have to have first revenue and it can be sustained. So that means you're going to be paying some kind of private money to get to revenue. Then you're going to look at boutique and larger scale venture capitalists for your growth money.
I want to go back to what you said about starting with the exit strategy from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. Simply logically, how does an entrepreneur focus on how am I going to sell this company while they're still focused on how to build it?
Usually, an entrepreneur knows what he wants. The hidden question behind the early days question, how are we going to exit this business? What are we going to do with it? The hidden question is, what kind of life do you want? Right. Are you meaning to run a publicly held company? Do you have the experience and the wish to build an empire that goes public and hundreds, millions of dollars and billions of dollars are in play under your management? You pretty much know if you want to be that kind of person. If you mean to make what we used to call your nickel million, which nobody wants anymore because it's not enough. Then you want to build a company and sell it, which in the boom days used to be called flipping a company within 2 years. You don't flip a company within 2 years. The reason that the venture capitalists expect a 5-year projection of your revenue and your profitability is because it takes at least 5 years to build a company that you can sell. And what they said in January at the CEO show was that window is now out to 6 to 8 years before an exit. So things are different. And the investment is more conservative because you have to sustain the growth of that company and the success of your company for 6 to 8 years now. Because people aren't buying on the sizzle anymore. They're buying on real results. So to know what you're going to do with your company has more to do with knowing who you are and what life you want to have. If you want, so one other question to an early entrepreneur is, what's your number? Always what's your number. What's the number at which you're satisfied? About 10 million, 5 million, 20 million. And is it before or after taxes? So that number starts to tell you whether you need to sell the company in 5 to 10 years or not, and whether you have talent to sustain all the way to that exit. And then some people don't want to sell the company. They want to build a company that they can work at for the next 20 or 30 years because they're interested in it and they don't care about the public recognition. And they can be very successful, often more successful in terms of wealth creation, by building a cash cow that kicks off annuities or dividends or royalties or whatever the kind of revenue stream is, and live a perfectly good life and never be in the spotlight and never sell it and never have that chunk of money. So the venture capitalists aren't going to touch that kind of company. So you're looking for a different kind of investor if that's your plan.
Something you said in there about the projection of numbers. I look at a lot of business plans in this space, which is predominantly entertainment, right? And content. I'm a content creator, not a technology person. Those are all much numbers. They don't look real on any planet, and yet investors look at them for some measure of reality. Where do those numbers come from? How and who vets
them? The entrepreneur supposedly builds them. The CEO or the chief financial officer, CFO, builds them. And they build them based on their assumptions about how their new product will bloom in the marketplace and what the adoption curve will be and how soon they will scale up to a certain level of sales and what it will cost to get those customers and run the business and support the business. Forget about support costs, right? And so as it scales, they need to keep building the infrastructure that makes the business still friendly to the consumer who's buying the service or the product. So they're building these numbers based on clear business assumptions about how fast they can grow and how much of the market they'll penetrate
and then they put the numbers together. Now, what's interesting to the venture capitalist who's looking at those numbers is not that the numbers look like a hockey stick. That's the favorite thing. You go along in the beginning, there's not much, and then at a certain tipping point, off it goes. Right. So, they all know that they're going to see a hockey stick. What they're looking at is, what's the assumptions underneath? When I meet my clients, put them together, I care more about listing the assumptions very clearly and proving the assumptions more than I care about what the numbers say. Because the venture capitalist who does a good due diligence, not all of them do, but more and more of them do, they're looking at how the management of the company is assuming that the market will respond and that they can execute. So the assumptions underneath the numbers tell the investors how the entrepreneur is looking at the world. And so they're reading the numbers as much for the personality and the effectiveness of the management team as they are for the numbers themselves.
Explain how Series A and Series B funding works.
Okay. Before Series A, there's usually seed capital. That's your uncle and aunt and, you know, your brother and your sister and your cousins. And friends and people who will get you going. Let's just assume that can go up to some $100,000. I've seen companies start with as much as $70,000 as their seed capital from friends and family to, you know, a mix of private investors who went up to somewhat less than $1 million. So call that seed. Okay. And Series A is your professional money. Your professional money, if you're not having your company out, if the product's not out yet, you're not likely to get to Series A. Product has to be out, and the Series A runs from $1 to $2 million or so. And you're getting that either from angel groups, or you're getting it from boutique VCs who see the potential of the business, and they see that you can execute against it, and you're in the market with some traction. So, you're already at revenue. Okay. So, if that's at the $1 million, $2 million on top of your seed capital, that's your Series A. Series B tends to be your early growth round. And that tends to run in like $5 million, you know, $5 million in to make sure that you, now that you've launched into the market, you can gain traction in an early market share and prove your business model and your revenue model. Then the growth capital comes after that. Series C generally runs 10 to 15 million. You've already proven the market. Now you're going to beat off competitors, make sure that your market share is under your control, and mount your defenses to keep gaining market share. If you can do that, you can bring in your Series C.
So, what kind of companies are you funding right now? You said the venture capitalists are much more optimistic. What are they looking at?
They love companies besides all those characteristics that we use with you. They look at companies in the spaces. Content companies, you know, media content companies, have to have distribution deals. Right? So, if you have content, either as an aggregation or an original content play, it's fine. But if you don't have distribution deals, you're not going to get professional funding. This isn't going to happen. That's the initial market proof for content companies. And technology companies, generally you're not getting past your seed capital or your Series A until you've launched something and there's initial revenue. And you're talking about $500,000 to $1 million is proof of concept that you can create revenue. So you need to show that you can sustain that revenue in order to get Series A and Series B. You have to show sustainable revenue and growth by the time you're getting to Series B. So that's tracked up. The companies that people like in the tech field, they love mobile, they like applications, that create platforms, that create other businesses. So there's a revenue model. So if you can build a technology platform that other people will build businesses around where you get a cut, not just an app that sits on somebody else's platform, but an app that spins off other apps. They want that, right? They want, all they're looking at is a serious return on investment for their risk. And they're talking, and they've always liked, venture capitalists have always liked a 10 to 20 times return on their investment. Never mind your revenue and your EBITDA and your profitability, never mind that. If they put in $2 million, they want to see back to them. They want to see $20 million or $40 million. Now, at CES January, one of my favorite venture capitalists joked that five times return is the new 10. So now they're actually getting much more rational that they'll be looking at a 5 times return on what they put in, and they're assuming they're going to go 6 to 8 years before there's an exit. So you can see why they're being more careful and more conservative. So he's going 10 times minimum return in 3 to 5 years.
So how much importance do venture capitalists put on the management team of the company?
Way high, way high. Because good ideas, they see good ideas all the time. And they see that first-time entrepreneurs, there's no proof they can execute. Right now, second and third time. Right, so one of my clients was on his fourth company, and he joined with another colleague of ours who was on his third company. They each had one or two clear successes, very public successes between them. So they came together to build a company. They got their first $20 million on a handshake, right? And they got their second $20 million 4 months later on a full business plan. Okay. Because they were proven entities. They had proven each of them could execute. And here was the guy who could build it and launch it. And here was the techie who could make sure the tech worked. They were proven in their other companies before they got together. And that's a no-brainer. For all the tier one famous VCs, corporate money was fine. Right? I'm off the air. I'm executing now. Somewhere year four now. Right? So that's easy. If you are a first-time entrepreneur, you need to attract experienced management in your market sector and do exactly what you need to execute against. So you need to bring in specialists who can do that. And you may have to have them agree that they will come on at a certain level of funding, because they're not likely to leave your successful job while you go look for it.
So, this $10, $20, and $40 million, who catches the money and how is it controlled once you get it? Because the stories that always came out of the tech bubble were, cars and buying offices and free
parties. No more. The money doesn't come in all at once. It's part of their benchmarks. Okay. So let's say you need $4 million. Right? And being you need $4 million to get to your next benchmark. Now, let's back up for just a second. If you're the CEO, if you're the entrepreneur, then you need to be showing your investors that this much money will get you to this level of success. And then, if you're smart, you should say, and then I'm going to need, I need $4 million and I'll get to this level of revenue and this many customers, and I will have closed these 5 big name companies and consider the bottom line. Okay, so that's a benchmark. If you get your $4 million, you can get to there. Okay. Then, if you're smart, you'll say, my plan after that is I will need $6 to $8 million. Right, or another $10 million to get to this level of market share on this acceleration. You should be able to fit if you're doing well enough. So you establish benchmarks if you're smart. This money gets you to there. And then if there are moments along the way where it can be broken into events on smaller benchmarks, then the venture capitalists may agree to set aside $4 million out of the portfolio, but only give you $1.8 million to get to here, and then another $1 million to get to there, and so on. And then you have to reach the benchmark before the money's been set aside. But if you fail, they haven't given it to you. and they learned a lot from the cars and the waste of money in the fancy offices. There is a thing in play now called capital efficiency. Love this word. And what venture capitalists really want to see is that you've built whatever car you've gotten before you come to them. You have built it on almost nothing. And you've not gotten it out of your head or want to be famous or bought fancy office and then you scraped it together. And that your plan, your projections, show that you're going to continue to scrape it together until you reach a point where you need to step up to something more efficient or more. If you have to put people in an office building, there's a moment when you have to, and there's a rationale for it. If you don't, you don't. And capital efficiency in terms of living virtually and what can be effectively done without that overhead, they really like that. They respect it. Because they believe then that you will handle their money the way you handle your own. So that's become a key, particularly since 2008.
So how do startup companies weather these financial crises that keep going up and down? We're in a recession. When they want to buy the product, but they don't have money to do it. So how do they establish at a point in time when potential purchasing power is diminished?
First of all, they use those capital efficiency strategies to keep their overhead low, which lets their margins work in their favor. Okay. Then, if it's at all possible, they save money. Saving money gets you through these crises. Okay. But if you're just starting, you're saving money. You're finding it together to keep moving. So, a lot of what has to happen is you keep testing your revenue model. So, you do a lot more testing than you used to, because when there was lots of money and plenty of fat in the economic infrastructure, people were lying just to buy. People loved to buy new electronics or new media. They did. Now, you will probably have to figure out ways to bundle new distribution channels, ways to adjust your pricing to meet the market need, which may mean that you segment your product in a different way so that there's a free version and then it steps up to a paid version. That's one way. Or there are certain things that are free and then there's a bundle that steps up. You look at the price points that your target market can tolerate and you may in fact segment your product to meet those different levels of spending. So there's product strategy with pricing strategy, with distribution strategy, all together that allows you to be flexible in a market that goes up and down in terms of your customers' buying preferences. And you do a lot of testing.
So what's the personality profile of the kind of entrepreneur that can succeed in this space? And you see frugality.
Yeah, frugality. I'm not so frugality, but it is. Okay. Persistence, right, flexibility. The flexibility to understand that just because you have a vision that you're going to put this product or this content into this market and it will work, may not be so. And if you're not flexible enough to tweak your product or your content or adjust your market or adjust up market or down market, change the pricing, then you're not going to succeed. So you can't be stuck on your idea. Many early stage ventures change their business model 2 or 3 times before they find a successful one. And venture capitalists actually will tolerate that because they know that it's true. And it isn't just the movement of the economic market. It's the fact that you don't know what a product's adoption is going to be used for. I mean, they invented ATM machines 30 years ago to do online banking, and they became cash machines. And I can give you a list of all the consumer products and what they meant to be used for that they never were used for and became something else, but they succeeded in something else. So since people in early entrepreneurial and venturing understand that there's adjustment to be made. So you need good management skills. I believe in technology. You need a really good techie. People who are not techies who build tech companies, I've been doing this for a really long time. if you have a technologist for hire or part-time or, you know, chief technology officers for rent, you can't sustain a technology company that way. So one of the founders needs to be a techie, and one needs to be business savvy. And somebody needs to know how to sell clothes, not just pitch, but clothes, not just capital, but revenue from the product itself.
And what is the key to closing? Why do so many people find it hard to be a closer on a deal?
It's hard. It's hard to close. I mean, most people can get enthusiastic and then they pitch softly or enthusiastically or organically or as they were trained to do. But asking for the sale is something that only certain kinds of people are trained to do and have the personality to do. If you go through the Bible of selling years ago was the Xerox training manual. The Xerox training manual says, you haven't heard the word no from your customer until you've heard it 8 times. And at that point, after number 8, you're allowed to deal with the objections in a serious way. How many people do know who can survive that? That's why.
Well, you know, people are afraid they'll, you know, they'll need it someone, which, you know.
Well, but, you know, salesmen love to be loved, right? Which is the reason it's very difficult for them to be chief executive officers, right? Because they love the love and they love the glamour, but they don't love the hard reality, right? So that's why you have a mix of men. That's why the venture capitalists look for that.
We only have a few minutes left, so I want to talk about the business of the time flies. How should an entrepreneur design a business plan?
Okay. There does have to be a business plan. It should be short. It should be no more than 20 pages written, and then a whole lot of numbers, a lot of proving your numbers. But what I need to say is that the business plan, no one looks at a business plan, they haven't looked at them for years, until they're seriously interested in investing. So you have to create a pitch. Now there's 2 ways to do that in format. You can have 3 pages, which tells your entire business plan story, and a summary of your financial numbers, right? A short summary, 5 years, top line, bottom line, EBITDA, that kind of thing. And what you do in that 3 pages is you make a soundbite out of every chapter of your business plan into 1 sentence or 2 sentences tops. Okay, that will fit into 3 pages if you do that. Right. Generally, people like to make PowerPoints, and investors expect PowerPoints. The rule of that is you don't get more than 12, right? 12 slides. Oh, that includes, hi, here's my name, and thank you for coming. Please give me your money. Mm-hmm. Right. Which means that when you get to your product or your content, you get 1, maybe 2 slides on it total. And most entrepreneurs want to talk about their product or their service or their content all the time. You have to train them not to. Because your pitch to investors is about what investors care about, not what your customers care about. Your customers care about the benefit to their company or whatever you're trying to sell them. Your investors only care, does this product in this space built by these guys to make this company create a return on investment that's at least 5 times what I'm going to put into it within the next 5 or 6 years? Can they do it? That's the only question they want answered. And so in your 12 slides, I think, it's not a debate about this, I think by slide number 3, you better tell them how much you're looking for. And if you're going to tell them what valuation you're thinking of, say it there. If you're not going to talk valuation, then you'll do the dance. But my experience of venture capitalists is that until you tell them the deal, they're not listening. Right? And you come in for your 45-minute meeting, and you have your 12 slides, and you've done your homework, and it all looks good. You probably only get 4 minutes before they interrupt you, if that. So you better put in your unique value proposition in the first slide, which your product space and why it's unusual and how it's going to scale and how come it's going to be a success. And what you're asking for in the first 3 or 4 slides, because they're going to interrupt you and the rest of the slides may never get addressed. So
You talked about employees who have three and four successful companies.
Mm-hmm.
What makes certain people successful serial entrepreneurs while others never manage to get one going?
They can suffer failure. They understand that failing in your attempt at a business is not failing as a person. And they get up and they do another one. That's the secret. That's what I used to tell my clients. I don't want to say thank you're an entrepreneur until you've won one, last one, and started a third. And one of my dearest clients said, I've lost two, does that count? But I said, it actually does count if you're learning from having lost the first two.
So, what are the technologies that are showing potential as being emerging trends?
Okay, on the consumer side, it will be mobile. It will be apps. It will be cloud, which is often more business than others. SaaS computing, all up in the cloud, SaaS services are a wonderful business model. And all the new technologies that change the way people behave and change the way businesses meet profitability, those are the core issues about why they'll work. In media is about, you can't predict a hit in any form of media. So I'm not going to go there. We all know we can't go there. Right. However, you can create a tech media play, company, product or service, such that you manage to have multiple revenue streams from every platform you can find. So as long as you can have, generally your plan should say, here's my content, here's why it's unique, and here's why it's going to make a difference on every platform, tablets and mobile, and big screens and little screens and all the new screens that are coming. Because in order to generate the revenue streams you need to grow, you need a revenue model for each of those screens that will work.
Okay. Trick question.
Even if you can't predict how media content will succeed, which I believe you can, how can you predict how media tech will succeed? You've got a better shot than with media tech. Because tech adoption is a separate market reality than content. So, if your content is going into traditional media platforms, you know what your model is and you'll succeed or not on the vagaries of how those work. When you go into new platforms and new forms of how content is delivered, you have the Wild West and you have a better shot.
Okay. So, I'm just going to wrap things up by reviewing the learning objectives because that's why we're here in the first place today. So, by now, you should be able to understand the origins of the Internet. You should be able to describe the various ways that the world uses the Internet. And you should be able to discuss the emerging trends in Web 2 functions and usage.
I want to thank you for coming, Joey.
I enjoyed it. And I want to urge you all to look at joeytamer.com. That's JoeyTamer.com. There it is. It is a wealth of knowledge. I've known you now professionally for about 4 or 5 years. Every time I talk to you, I come away feeling, I didn't know that. So you've been able to experience one of the best and brightest in the venture capital and consulting stage. Thank you so very much. We'll be back here next week, same time, same place. Take a look at Blackboard students, and we will all see you next week. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
You are watching VHTV, television program service of California State University, the Davis Hills.